awesome, and we're glad that you're part of it. And today what we want to talk about is this, is how do we make room? How are we going to make room for this? Some people struggle with that and go, I don't know if I have enough myself to be part of this. And some people are a little bit intrepidated to say, I think I see the need, but I don't feel like I could actually maybe help with that. Or maybe you're looking around and maybe you feel like, I don't know how this church is going to meet this need, because I'm looking around and I don't see a lot of rich people. I don't know if you are or not, but I don't think we haven't catered to a very rich crowd. So how are we going to do this, and why are we doing this, and is it going to give till you hurt, or are we going to come up with something, or how is God going to do this? And I want to make sure you know how to be part. We've covered several things in this series, and we've been taking a look at a parable, and I just want to share one verse of the parable that we've been looking at in this series, Luke chapter 14, and this is in your outlines. If you could put it up on the screen. Luke chapter 14 and verse 23, he said this. He said, then the master told his servant, go out in the roads and the country lanes and compel them to come in so that my house will be full. And that's been kind of the verse that we've used for this entire series. Jesus was teaching a parable to some people that thought they were better than everybody else and they were taking the high seats and everything. And he said, it's as though there was a rich man who had a banquet, And some of his friends that he invited to, just like we invite people to a wedding, didn't show up for the banquet. And he was very angry because they RSVP'd. You ever had that where it's like you plan a big event like we're doing tonight and you RSVP'd and then didn't come and then we're not going to be happy? No, I'm just playing. But it's like a wedding where you go, man, you spent a lot of money. And so they come to this dinner and they didn't show up. And he said, fine, just let the poor people come in. And then he said, go out in the highways and the byways and compel those that don't even know about this to come in. And we said the parable represents that God is wanting people that don't know about his son Jesus to be able to come in to the banquet at the end of time. That's what it's talking about. And it's saying it's our job to be the servant, to go out in the highways and the byways and even the country lanes like Zuna. Okay, I'll work you in somehow. To compel people to come in to have a relationship with God. Okay, that we have to be able to compel. That's our job, to be the servant. So we've been taking a look at several things here. We talked about the first Sunday. We talked about why. Why do we want to do this? The second Sunday, we talked about the excuses for why we don't think we can do this, okay? That we talked about what's behind the excuse for why people are not in relationship with God, that oftentimes is a hurt. It's a sin. It's something keeping them from God. Sometimes it's just too many priorities. It's not that we have a lot of bad things. We just have so many good things that we have so many priorities, we have no priorities. Does that make sense? And so we said, hey, how do you get past that? So if you missed these messages, newbranch.net is our website, and you can listen to them. In the third message, which was last Sunday, we talked about how does that work? How do we know what the Holy Spirit wants us to do? Giving money, that's one piece of it. But also using our gifts and talents, witnessing, evangelizing. And we talked about the prompting of the Holy Spirit and how it's as though God is the conductor and we are his servants. And how do we hear his voice? How could you pray every day and hear God's voice? If you missed that, go back and listen to it, because it's very essential to what we're talking about. And today we want to talk about how can God use people like us that only have a little bit? How can God use people like us? And why would he do that? Doesn't he save that for people that have more money? Doesn't he save that for somebody that has more gifts and talents? Doesn't he save that for people that are less extended than we are right now? Anybody feel like that? Like, let me just ask a question. Does anybody feel like they just have a lot of extra money at the end of their paycheck that are going, you know what, I didn't know what to do with this, and so I'm coming to make room tonight because I got so much extra, right? And that's kind of what we're thinking. We're going, man, I hope there's some people like that, because I'm not one of them, right? And I'm thinking to myself, when we started this project, I was like, I'm not one of them. You know, I got a son, he's getting ready to graduate high school, and I'm going, I don't know, this is a great time, right? So why are we doing this? And we're doing it for this reason. We like the reason, but how, right? Some of us are getting very realistic with this, and we're going, I'm sorry, I've done the math. I don't think this is going to work. And today I want to tell you how, okay? Because I have a feeling that the story we're going to tell today, it may not be a profound story in the sense of never heard it before, but it's profound. It's just not new. And you can very easily go, hey, I've heard that story a bunch of times. I just didn't realize it applied to me, but it does. It's shared in the scripture because it applies to us. And the story is found in Matthew, in the book of Matthew, Matthew chapter 14. So we went from Luke chapter 14 to Matthew 14. And here's what it is. Jesus had started his earthly ministry. Many people had gathered, and he comes, and it says this, when Jesus landed and he saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them and healed their sick. The first place I want to start today is I want you to circle the word compassion. The first message we talked about, passion. The second message we talked about, how do you get your passion back? And what I want us to focus on today is this. It's Jesus' compassion. And compassion has to do with his passion. Does that make sense to everybody? So just understand, Jesus saw the crowd, and he saw them. It's very important to us that Jesus saw us when we were at our lowest. And he took the time to come to these people and to heal them. And the story proceeds. I mean, there was a whole bunch of people that came, and there were so many sick, it was overwhelming, even to his apostles, and they were so overwhelmed. And then it says this in verse 15. As the evening approached, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a remote place." I can't make this stuff up. I mean, much like a small community that we know of. I don't know how to keep working Zunai into my messages, but it just fits, right? Jesus went to some remote place. Let me explain what the problem was here, because you're going to understand it in just a minute. You folks that live in Zunai, you're going to understand exactly what I'm talking about in about 10 seconds, okay? As the evening approached, the disciples came to him in this remote place, and it's already getting late. "Send the crowds away so they can go to the village and buy themselves some food," okay? So it's as though Jesus had a huge crusade in a place like Zunai, okay? That wasn't very well thought out, because there's not a lot of places, if I'm not mistaken, there's not a lot of places to eat in Zunai, right? And they roll them streets up at 5 o'clock. You know, so if you're there after 5, you're going to starve to death. There's no Walmart. There's no Food Line. There's nothing out there, right? I mean, and so they're going, "Hey, man, these people are getting hungry, and I think some of them are Baptists. So, you know, you're going to have to wrap it up, and send them off," right? He was going a little bit long, you know, where the deacons are saying, "Man, I don't know what you're going to do. You can preach as long as you like, but we end the service at 12. And that's kind of where they were at with it, right? And so they're hungry, and he's saying, and they're looking at the need, and they understand. They're saying, Jesus just did some incredible things here. But Jesus is about to do something else incredible that could be easily missed. He had spent all day ministering to them and healing them. Let me tell you how you can do a longer service. When you start healing people, that's pretty awesome, right? When you say, "Come up, you got cancer, you don't have it no more. You've been blind since birth, you're no longer blind." I'll tell you what, services can go on as long as you want, right, when people do stuff like that. When the work of God starts to move, it don't matter how long, you'll stay there all day. And so they're saying, "Hey, man, these people are starting to get hungry, it's getting night, and if we keep them here, they're going to be, we didn't, Jesus," I can understand this, and my wife says, "Do not compare yourself to Jesus, because that's not the same, okay? Because he had a plan, you don't, John." But it's lack of planning. Can you see this? Jesus shows up, and it's like a flash mob showed up, and they went, "Jesus, we did not plan for a dinner." You know, right? Like, the logistics people are going crazy. You ever done that? And I've announced some stuff from the stage, "Hey, guys, we're going to be doing this," and my logistics people are going, "What?" And they're thinking of all the things they're going to have to do to make this happen. And the disciples are doing the same. They're like, "We have a couple thousand people here. I mean, like 5,000 people here. We can't feed them. What are you doing? You can't do that. We didn't plan for this, Jesus. You got to let us know so we can kind of bring some food along and stuff like that." And so they're like, "Hey, wrap it up so we can send these people off. Maybe you didn't know that." And Jesus says this, verse 16. Jesus replied, "They do not need to go away. You," I want you to circle every time you see the word "give" in this passage of Scripture. "You give them something to eat." Now, I don't know about you, but you go, "I'm sorry, did you think we prepared for this, Jesus? Because we didn't have the memo, right? We didn't come together before this and have a plan to be part of this thing. You just sprung this on us today, right? I mean, like, there's 5,000 people, and you said, give them something to eat." You are realizing Jesus, it doesn't do things by mistake, right? He had waited for this moment, because he's about to do something incredible with them. Can I stop there and maybe interject us into this equation? Jesus is about to do something incredible with us. And they're sitting there looking, and they're thinking, "What? You want us to feed them?" He's like, "Yeah, I've done all the miracles, you feed them." It's not exactly like that, but that's kind of how they took it. It's like, "I'm sorry, we don't have anything. You want us to go out and hunt something down? You want us to go fish something out of the water? What is it? I don't know what you want us to do, but we don't have enough." You get the idea? And that's kind of the feeling they have. But I want you to see it. Jesus asked them to give. Can I tell you something? I believe he's doing the same with us today. Okay, verse 17. We have. Here's what we have. Okay, so where did they start? And this is the best place to start. They started off really well. And then there's one part of this. So I want to make sure you get both pieces, okay? Here's what we have. But by the way, that's all we have, okay, only. So here's what they say. We have here only, circle the word "we have" and "only." We only have 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. Every time I tell the story, I tell it was 2 loaves of bread and five fish. I don't know why I do that. I'm dyslexic. But that's all that they had. Okay? And when I say this, this was basically a bag lunch for a little boy there. So I don't think it meant loaves like five big loaves of bread like we think of in the grocery store. I think it meant like five little pieces of bread that you could put together to make a sandwich. That's kind of what it means, okay? You get the idea? Here's what we come up with. Jesus, you want us to feed 5,000 people? The only thing we have is a fish sandwich. And these people don't like fish, okay? I mean, you get the idea? I mean, all we have is chitlins, and I'm sorry, not everybody's from Zuna, okay? I mean, that kind of thing. And so sorry. We'll work in anywhere we can. All right, so we only have this fish sandwich, a fish fillet. You know what I'm saying? You know, what are we going to do with this? You get how funny that seemed to them? This was not a legitimate, we have this. So understand, it would have been well if they said, here's what we have. But that's not what they said to Jesus. What they're saying is, it's a sarcastic comment to go, you want us to feed 5,000 people? That's all we got. This is laughable. In fact, just, you know, and we're going to take this from this little boy. You want us to take the food from a little boy and feed 5,000 people? That's stupid, right? You see how dumb this seems? Can I tell you that some of us feel that way? When we start talking about, hey, we're gonna put all our money together and see what God can do, we think it's kind of stupid, don't we? I mean, let's just be honest. All right, Matthew 14, verse 18 says this. Okay. Bring them here to me. I think they were shocked at this. You want to circle something? Bring them here to me. You know, they were joking, like, I don't even think they had the fish in their hand. They're like, one little boy has this thing, and he's like, oh, is that what we have? And he took it as a legitimate thing, said, all right, well, bring me what you have. And they were dumbfounded. They're like, okay. I don't think they even in their wildest dreams thought he was going to do anything. They thought it was ridiculous, right? Verse 19. And he directed the people to sit down on the grass. The people are there. You're picturing this, right? Jesus is going to his disciples in front of everybody. And this isn't done off stage. This is done in front of 5,000 people. As though if I said, hey, Kathy, come on up. We're going to feed all these people here today. She's like, what? Right? But I do it in front of everybody. I wouldn't do that. Kathy would actually kill me. But you get the idea. I mean, like, that's crazy, right? And what he does is they bring up this little bit of food, right? And he tells everybody on the lawn, we're going to have a picnic. Everybody sit down. And they're all going, what is going on, right? And he directed them to sit down on the grass, taking the five loaves and the two fish and looking up to heaven. This is a very important piece of the equation. He changes his focus from the disciples who had all the reasons why they can't do this. He changed it from the crowd who had a bigger need than what they had the means to meet. And he changed his focus to heaven. You get it? He looked to heaven, and what did he do? He gave. You want a circle? This is the order. I mean, I'm telling you, if you want an equation for your life, if you want to know how God can meet miraculous needs, here it is right here. Taking the five loaves and the two fish, he looking up to heaven, he gave thanks, and he broke the loaves. Now, what that means, it doesn't mean nothing to us because we don't usually break people's bread. We don't usually touch people's bread. I don't really like that too much, do you? But, you know, I don't know. We pass around biscuits and people are throwing them around the table. We do that. So what Jesus is doing, you know, like that's our family. But what he's doing is that's their custom. When they thank and they're ready to share, they share their food. So it's basically, hey, it all comes out of one loaf. And so he breaks it. And what that represents is, it represents a lot of things, but it represents one thing. We're about to have a meal, and they are all looking like, this is stupid. I mean, what is he doing? He's unlost his mind, right? I mean, that's what they feel like. Like, to watch him do this, it must have been amazing. And they gave thanks, and he broke the loaves, and then he gave, circle that. Then he gave them to his disciples. He took what they had. He prayed to God with what they had. And then he gave it back to them. And they're thinking, oh, what are we supposed to do with that? And then he gave it to them. And then the disciples gave. You see the picture? They gave what Jesus gave back to them. They already had it. They gave it to him. He gave it back to them and said, go feed the people, right? Gave them to the people. In verse 20. I don't know. I mean, like, this doesn't seem spectacular just the way it's worded, but this is, right? I mean, this is, like, huge. They all, can you circle that? They all ate and were satisfied. I don't think you're excited enough, right? I mean, they all ate. I mean, like, they took these, I mean, how did that happen, right? Five loaves, five pieces of bread, and two little fish, and he fed 5,000 people, but not only, they didn't just take a little bit piece of it and eat a crumb, they were all satisfied from this huge meal. And when it was over, the disciples picked up 12 baskets full of broken pieces that were left over. Jesus took what they had and multiplied it and satisfied everybody. And by the way, they all ate, including the little boy. The little boy that you think, you took the little lunch from the little boy. Everything he had. His mom packed that lunch. Don't you feel bad about taking what he had? No, not when you give it to God. Not when that's what God is asking for, right? Verse 21. And the number of those who ate was about 5,000 men besides women and children. It's one of the most incredible stories in the Bible. Those that were there that day, their life was changed, right? Because they saw a miracle. He had done miracles before. He had compassion on them. And then he did this. But I want to point out a couple of things as it applies to us and as we're thinking about how to make room. And when we talked about make room in this series, we've said, hey, it isn't just about money, although that's a component, okay? We're praying about, hey, what does God want us to give together? What does God want us to do? But if we're not careful, we're going to think make room is about just getting money. And I don't want to, I know I've been to fundraisers before where people are raising funds and they're kind of lying about it and they're telling you it's about something else and it really isn't about anything else, it's only about money. But I need to explain something today. This is more than just a fundraiser, although we want to raise funds, right? We believe that, hey, we want to make the biggest invite that we can to the community, and we believe that our building is a component of that. Now, as we look down the road 3 years from now, we go, we really believe we're going to need more facility. And if we don't get ahead of it, we're going to get there, and the harvest is going to come, and we're going to go, we got no room to store the harvest. We got no room to reach out to more. But here's the problem. I don't think we have enough to get this done, first off. Second, the other problem is this. It's not a matter of just writing a check. And the scary part is this, is what we've been trying to cover in this series is, what you go, well, you haven't talked about money much. No, I've talked about the power of the Holy Spirit, because before we can make room for other people, before we can make room for even giving, we have to make room for the power of the Holy Spirit, which is what we talked about last Sunday. And this goes right along with it, because he can take what we have and multiply it. But here's the problem. If we think that we can just write a check and be done, if you're thinking, you know, I don't even need to come to that meeting tonight because all I got to do is write a check and that's really all you want, so I don't even need to come and hear all that stuff, then you're missing the point. Because this is about coming together for God's vision to accomplish what he wants, which is bigger than what we can do, okay? And if it's not bigger than what we can do, I don't think we're doing it right, because normally God is calling us to something that only he can do, okay? So here's what I want to do. I want to give you just three things, how to make room, okay? How do you make room? When God is calling you to do something, how do you make room? And the first thing that I see in this story is this, is you start with God. You start with God's vision, not your ability. The reason why God's visions oftentimes get shot down is because they're typically seemingly impossible. But when God starts something, he doesn't usually start with the possible. He starts with what it is he wants to accomplish. By the way, it works in other areas of your life, too. I mean, it works practically in every area. When you go, we want to go to the moon. Well, that's impossible, right? How many people said it was impossible? We did it. That's just a human thing. But now we're talking about in God's realm. And God's saying, I don't need you to tell me all the realistic parts of it. And we need to look at that, right? We need to count the cost. We need to see what God's saying. We need to come together. And then we need to bring a plan and all those kinds of things. God is in the planning and all that kind of stuff. But if we're not careful, what we're going to think make room is our plan, right? Our money. What God can do with the little bit we have, and it's laughable, because here's what I know. Even if you give everything you have, it's not enough to do what God needs to do, because you can't affect the heart, right? We can bring all the money in the world, and here's the problem. You can write the check. And here's the problem. If you're not seeing God's vision, if you're not catching God's vision, that's why we wanted to give it. Hey, we're preaching about it. We're talking about it. We're praying about it. We're coming together and fasting and praying about it. We're coming together to hear a vision tonight. But here's what I know. If you just write a check, here's the problem. We can build a huge building. Maybe somebody's wealthy enough. I don't know. Maybe somebody's wealthy enough to write one check, and we get the whole thing taken care of. And then we get there, and it's devoid of the power of the Holy Spirit. And guess what? We've gathered a huge crowd. We got a great show. I've been part of these things. And no power of God. It doesn't work. Because we didn't come here to gather a crowd. We came here to reach the one and compel the one to come in while there's still time. And we can't do that apart from the Holy Spirit. And what it takes is the unity of believers coming together. And then what God is saying is, I want you to be part so that I can increase your faith. You know what? That little boy that gave his sandwich, right? Any chance that anyone thinks, that anybody thinks that it was the sandwich that did it? You can go back one slide, Heather, because we're not quite ready yet. Anybody think it was the sandwich? It's not, right? It was God. And what I want to make sure you focus on before we get to the next point, that's why I took it off the screen, because it's so important that we don't move past this too quickly. Do not start with your ability. You start with what God has, what God is desiring. We don't start with, we can't accomplish this. We start with, what is God asking us to do? And then believe that he's going to accomplish it. So don't start with your abilities. Don't start with what's possible. Start with what God is calling you to do. Because nobody that day thought they were going to feed 5,000 people until 5,000 people were satisfied. And God did a miracle. I believe he can do it again. Okay, number two. Number one, you start with God's vision, not your abilities. Number two, you give God what you have and you trust him to meet the need. One of the issues that we're going to have is this, is some of us are going to be compelled to give more than God is calling us to give. Don't do that. Don't call faith something that you're giving outside of what God. That's why I told you we're going to pray. That's why we're not giving tonight. Why? Because we want you to look at the vision. We want you to hear what we have to say and come together, and you might have ideas and we might have ideas. And here's what I know. Whatever God is laying on your heart to give, it's going to be more than enough to meet the need that God wants. Okay? And who knows how he'll meet the need. We're not telling God how to do it. It may not be through our offerings. We may get there and go, we just don't have enough. Okay, then what else do we have? And God has met needs. I'm telling you, this church has been nothing if it hasn't been a miracle of how God has brought us together and provided for our needs above and beyond anything we can imagine. But here's what I know. You give God what you have and trust him to meet the need. There's another part to this, but you got to give God what you have. The problem is this, is that some people are going to be challenged above, and you're going to go, God wants me to give this huge amount, and I don't know how he's going to do it, but he's impressed on me to give just like little boy everything I have, and I don't know how that's going to work, but I know he has, and I don't want to hold you back from giving that either. You do what God is calling you to do. Yeah, but I don't have a lot. Yeah, I know. And we would think, and we would tell you, and we kind of project and try to figure out what you can give. That's not what I want you to do. You do need to add it up, but you pray to God, and whatever he's calling you to give, then that's what you give in this area and other areas of your life. This is just one area. You give God what you have, and then trust him to meet the need and your need. A lot of us are going, man, if I give that, I don't know if my needs are going to get met. You see, what if I have an emergency that comes up? But you cannot outgive God. Let me tell you what happened in the story where they fed the 5,000. You know what happened there? The little boy got to eat too. And 5,000 people. And forever, we will remember him as the boy who gave the sandwich that fed 5,000 people. Is that amazing? See, God uses what we have. It's not that God needs what we have. Do you think he needs what we have? You know how silly they get upset when I say this, but I'm not kidding when I say the church... God's church doesn't need our money to go forward. Jesus said, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. I doubt that he really needs our help. Then why do we give, right? What's the compelling reason why we give? He uses what we have, but understand he's multiplying what we have. A God who created the world out of nothing, I really doubt he needs our resources. Is that true? And there's a lot of people that use that argument for why they don't give, because they've actually added it up and they're very logical, and I've heard them. They're going, well, I'm sorry. If God has everything, then why are you asking me? Because I don't hardly have nothing. Maybe he could give me some of what he has. And you know what God's doing? He's going, yeah, I understand. But why did he ask his apostles in this story? Have you ever thought about that? He could have just fed everybody. He could have said, watch this, and just made food appear, right? He could have. But why? Because God has used the catalyst. You know what? God could cause the rocks to cry out and people would get saved, but he didn't. He left one thing to make it happen, and it's his church. And the conduit between us and the unsaved, or what? The conduit between God and the unsaved is the church. That is our job. We are the catalyst. And he's saying, I will take the little bit that you have, and I will meet the need, not just for them, to increase your faith. Nobody's thinking that the sandwich fed 5,000 people. I hope we're not thinking that, right? But God uses what we have. And this is not just an obscure principle in one story that I'm taking out of context. This is the story of the Bible. That God uses the little bit that people has, and he says, I not only want to increase the faith of the people that you're going to reach, I want to increase your faith by being part He don't give us the whole story. You know what he does? He's the conductor, just like we talked about last week. You give this little bit. What good? You know, the problem is this. What good is my little bit going to do? Well, really, nothing except for one thing. God is in the equation. And he's calling you to do it because he wants to use the little bit you have in a way that you can't even imagine. You see what he did here? 5,000 people got to eat. Let me say something. You know what he said to Moses? You've might maybe heard this before, but sometimes we've heard the stories, but we really haven't heard them. We've never let them set inside. We didn't realize that the scripture was for our edification and our help to increase our faith. This is huge. And you know what he said here? He said to Moses, when Moses was 80 years old, Moses at age 40 wanted to be in charge, right? And he killed an Egyptian, and he was every bit the leader that God needed, right? Or at least he thought he was, in his own human ability. This is why I say it's not just about writing a check. And he whacked off the Egyptian guard's ear, and their people didn't rise up with him, and he fled as far as he could go and realized he's all by himself without the power of God, right? And for 40 years, he spent on the backside of a desert in a little town called Zunai. No, I'm just playing. In a little town called, I'm going to work y'all in Harry Town. I love you guys, all right? See, Moses was there. He went there, right? That's obscurity. And, okay. and what did he do? He spent 40 years in Midian doing what? Nothing, right? Nothing. Just mundane, day after day after day. As what? As God helped Moses understand, it takes God's power to fulfill God's calling. That isn't about Moses' abilities. It's about God. And then he comes to the burning bush, and what does he say? I can't do it. And that's exactly what God wanted to hear. I've heard it told that he had lack of faith, and he did. But here's the problem. You know why God loved that? Because he had lack of faith in himself, and he started to put his faith in God, and that's exactly what God wanted. And so when he comes to the burning bush, what does God say? He's like, Moses, what do you have in your hand? And Moses is like, God, I've been a shepherd for the last 40 years. I'm no longer a leader. I have lost all my confidence. I'm getting old. Everything hurts on my body. I'm old, man. I can't do this anymore. I might have been able to do it before, but I can't do it now. And God says what? No, that's not what I asked you, Moses. I asked, what do you have in your hand? I have a staff, Lord. This is not a sword. This is a staff. You know what he did with that staff? Every single miracle that was done with the staff in his hand because God was saying, I can take a little and do a lot. Anybody think it was the staff that had the power? No, it was the power of God. But please, 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 when we talk about the little bit that we give, do not underestimate it because you have no idea the power of what you have. You do not know. Because when I look at the staff, let me tell you something. When they went there, he threw it down and Pharaoh believed him because it turned into a serpent, remember? When he did the miracles, he would hold up the staff. When he was at the Red Sea, what did he say? Stretch out your staff, and the Red Sea parted. You know what the worst sin for Moses in his life was that kept him out of the Promised Land was when he took the staff and he hit the rock. I don't know if you know the story, but if you read the book of Exodus and Numbers, you will read about an account where Moses gets angry with the people. You ever been around people and they're just frustrating and irritating? Must have been church people, but okay. And so what he did, right? All right, they're frustrated and they don't have enough water and they don't have enough this and they don't have enough that, and he's been doing this for over 40 years because it's their fault, and he gets angry and he strikes the rock. And God says, you're not going into the Promised Land. But understand the reason why, because you may never have known why that was so big of a deal. Because he did it with the staff. When you belittle the little bit that God has given you, you have no idea what you're belittling. Because God's saying, that represents my power. But I can only donate $1 a month, okay? But you're going to hold on to it, you see? Because that's just not enough. God can't do anything with that. Yes, he can. I'm not so sure that God doesn't multiply what we have now, right? Because we never look. There's a reason why we don't want to number it. There's a reason why we don't want to say what everybody's given. You want to know why we don't want to tell what everybody's given? Because we don't know for sure that God isn't multiplying it as it goes in. You get the idea? And we don't want to give credit to a person. Let me say something. Moses was one example. The little boy was another example. Elisha, remember we covered the story of Elisha. And what happened with the story of Elisha? He came to a widow lady and God said, I want you to get one more meal, right? That where I've miraculously provided during this time of famine for you has dried up. And now this lady's going to provide you a meal. And he gets there and the lady says, well, I can't because this is the last meal that I have. But you know what Elisha did? Because he had such great faith in God, I would have said, been embarrassed, right? And going, what did you just do to me, God? I'm asking for the last meal the lady has before her and her son dies. And Elisha says, will you trust God? Give me a little bit of that meal. Now, do you think Elisha needed a meal? No, it's not about that. Do you think God needed a little bit the lady had? No, no, no. It was about faith. And as she gave in faith, guess what happened? He multiplied what she had, and they had enough food for all of them. See, we're scared because we're going, if I give the little bit, scarcity mentality. If I give the little bit I have, I'm not going to have enough. But the truth is God will take it and multiply it, and not only will he bless the thing, he'll bless you too. Because it's faith. What happens is it gets inside. Why did Elisha want to do that? Because he had seen day after day, God met his need with a raven. God met his need at a brook where there was water and there was food. And he goes, you know what? I know this, that God will provide. And I don't have that scarcity mentality anymore. You see, when you don't have a little bit, sometimes there's that scarcity. You'd have to be poor to understand. Anybody ever ate ramen noodles because you had to? Right? You know what I'm talking about. You're going, a little nervous right now, right? But here's what happens. You get that scarcity mentality, and it's the same thing we see with people that came from the Holocaust where they'll just stuff their pockets with food, and they can't get enough because they're relying on that stuff. And what the giving process is for God is as you give, it breaks that thought, and it changes your focus from what you have, which is scarce, to what God has, which is lots. Because you can't get enough, right? Consumerism says what? I want more. And the more you get, the more you need. But when God takes over, guess what he does? He goes, I'm only going to give you exactly what you need. But for the Christian, we go, well, you know what? That's more than enough. Because here's what we know. God can do a lot with a little. I'm telling you. If you grab this principle, let me tell you something. David, when he's facing the Philistine giant, Goliath, you remember? Young teenage boy. And he goes out. And he has this moment of faith where the Holy Spirit comes upon him, and he says, I will kill the giant. And then he goes, oh, my gosh, what am I going to do this, right? You ever done that? I've done that a lot. Big talk in a moment, and then you get out there on the field, and you're thinking, not sure this was a great idea. How's this going to work? And the guy's yelling. He's yelling at him and saying all kinds of atrocities and what he's going to do to you and your whole family, and he's killed tens of thousands of people in his lifetime, and he's fully decked out military soldier. And you know what God uses to kill him? David doesn't dress up in armor. David doesn't do anything different. He takes his sling and a rock, and he kills a giant. Now, I can't tell you today how to kill a giant with a sling. This isn't about how great David was with the sling, trust me, okay? I don't care how great you are. When a person's fully decked out in military garb, you don't kill him with a sling. But God can. God can slay the giant. You see the picture? God can do a lot with a little. If you want to spend the next 3 hours, I can go through the rest of the Bible and tell you story after story after story of what God can do with a little bit. But God expects us to give it. This is the part, and this is where, if there was a part of this make room thing that I'm nervous about, is this, two things. One is that you'll either give too much or you'll give too little, or you won't give it all because you think what you have doesn't make a difference. And it has nothing to do. Here's what I know. You might have all the money in the world, but your heart ain't right. Don't give it. I'm telling you straight up, because this is not just about money. This is about the power of the Holy Spirit, and it doesn't work that way if you just write it. And you know what? I'm not going to be part, but I'm just going to write the money. Then don't do that, because you're not part. We need you to be part. And I know other people, hey, God will use the other people's money. That's fine. But what I want you to do is this, because here's what I know. The blessing isn't just because you gave, but it's when you understand who you're giving to. And when we say the reason we're giving isn't because John has a great vision or what we're going to say tonight or that we're so awesome or that we just want better stuff for us, but when we go, we see the compelling vision of God that says, you know what? I once was where those people were. I once was behind the gates of hell too. I once had what they did. And you know what I want to do? I want to give some money so we can kick in the gates of hell and be part of Jesus' mission. Not ours. That's what God dreamed, right? We start not with where we are, but with God's vision. You see? And once we see that, then we stop saying what we can't do, and we say, hey, God, I don't know how you're going to do this, but this is all I got. And then God takes that little bit, and you know what he does? He does stuff like he did right here already. You know how I know? Because he's already done it once. And I believe he can do it again. You see, the compelling vision is Jesus looked out, and he said, there's 5,000 people out there that need to eat. Let me tell you the compelling vision for where we're at. There's 30,000 people in a 45-minute drive that have no church home. They're driving down the country lanes. They're in Zunai. Trust me when I say this, and I say it jokingly, but I mean it with all my heart. I love the people in Zunai, but there are many lost people in Zunai. You know them? I know some of them. I don't know some of them. And I haven't taken the time to get to know some of them. And I'll never have the time to get to know some of them, but you will. And we have to do the best we can to compel them to come in while there's still time. And that's what this is all about. And we give the little bit we got, and God takes the little bit we got, and it's unbelievable what he can do with it, okay? It starts with God's vision. We give God what we have and trust him to meet the needs. And the last thing is this. This is a very important piece of this puzzle, and that's this. Don't forget to give God all the glory. Now, it sounds silly because I doubt that day the boy went home to his mama and said, Mama, you ain't going to believe this. I fed 5,000 people. Maybe he did, right? But the story could be rewritten. It says, I fed 5,000 people with my lunch. That's dumb, isn't it? Any more than Elisha and the lady saying, I gave Elisha food and then it lasted all this time and it was me that did it. This is how we rewrite the books. Let me tell you, I've read a lot of church planting books because I've been part of it. And half of them are how we did it. Let me tell you, the human way of building a church. God forbid that we go there, right? But we could. What if we get a new building? What if we get the best show in town? What if we're the, you know, three-ring circus or whatever we are, you know, Six Flags Over Jesus? I don't know. Go back to the other slide just for one second. All right? What if we have all that? I'm all for promotion and all that kind of stuff. But here's the problem is if we ever rewrite this to saying this is what we did, we lost it. What this is going to do is this. It's going to increase your faith to go give all the glory to God because you're going to go, God, I don't know how you're going to do this. Can I tell you where we started this? I don't know how you're going to do this, God. But I know you're calling us to do it. We start with his vision. And we look to the future. And when it happens and we stand there, imagine that day we stand there. Here's what I want you to visualize today. I want you to visualize standing there, and the person sitting next to you is the one we reached to make room for. You know, I want you to picture a kids' church that's vibrant and kids that wouldn't have known Christ, that only would hear from the public school education system. But instead, what they heard was they heard a message of God that changed their lives, and now they don't have the scars that we do. I want to see a teen ministry that comes together, right? And there's teens in there that go, hey, their parents don't even come to church, but because of us, they went down a different track. You know what I'm saying? You see that? Our friends, our loved ones, a church full of people in Zuna, and they finally just lynched me. You know, I'm just playing. Because there's so many of them. We didn't even realize there's that many people out in Zuna, but there are hundreds of people, thousands of people. 30,000 people that don't know, and they're driving down the road, and they're scared. And if you watch the news after this election, you know it's true. Some people are celebrating, and some people are not. And even the people celebrating are scared of the people that are not. And the people that are not are scared of the people that are. And you're going, this country is divided, and wouldn't it be nice to have one foothold into our community that would say, Jesus Christ can help you with that. There's a Christ that no matter what your circumstances are, he can be there for you. That's what we're making room for. Imagine that. And imagine a day if we backed that up and said, hey, you know what? In order to make that happen, I get to be part. That's what we're talking about. Making room for God, not just a check. Please, please, please get it. If you will be part, God will do a lot with a little. Let me tell you something. I don't think anybody, I've never known, when you read the stories in the Bible, you watch how it affected those people. Not one of them. They didn't forget who the glory was. You see, the problem is, if you just write the check, you're going to get all the glory. Here's what we're going to do, and I'll tell you what we're not going to do. Well, you can do it if you get rid of me. No placards. Okay? No placards on the chairs. Hey, I gave that. God gets all the glory. You see, the reason why we sat in these chairs, Let me tell you something. There was somebody that went before us. You know, the reason why I'm here today is because somebody before us spent an incredible amount to get me here. I'll tell you straight up, if the church would tithe, if everybody that was part of our church family would actually tithe, we wouldn't even need to raise money. Did I know that? But there are people. Let me tell you something. That's not a guilt message. Let me tell you what it is. It's a message from somebody that one time in my life I couldn't give a tithe, not because of the finances. I thought it was financial. It was my heart. It was my spirit. I couldn't. I was broken. I was crushed. I didn't know it, but I was. And I couldn't give. And somebody gave. And today I'm here. And today I can give a tithe. And today, you know what I can do? I can make room. I can give beyond that to help more. You know what? Well, you know, I'm hoping for this Make Room project. I'm hoping it's so big that it goes beyond our lifetime. Wouldn't that be something? if it sat here as a beacon of light, not the building, the people. Who cares if they take it and tear it down? Who cares if it comes so oppressive that the church no longer has buildings? It doesn't matter. Because making room for God is going to do one thing. It's going to be a movement. And what I see is this, and I don't want you to miss it. The reason why I'm so excited is I don't want you to miss this. Because you could miss the greatest movement of God that's about to occur right here, not just in New Branch, but in our area amongst our churches. And we're going to partner with everybody we can to reach the one while there's still time. And I want you to be part of it. And if we were to come together, imagine if we were to come together tonight at 6:30. Now you can put the other slide up. Imagine if we were to come together tonight at 6:30 and we were to come around that vision. And we take our plans, and God laughs at them a little bit, okay? I think he will. Just like a parent with their child, right, when they're trying to make something, and they're bringing that before their parent, and they're not laughing because they're making fun of them. He's not making fun of us. But our plan is a little bit funny to God, right, because we don't have it all right. Some of us, we don't hear God exactly right. We don't know what we're doing. And so we're not going to get all this right. I just want to be clear. We didn't get it right at the start, and we won't get it all right now. But I believe this, if we were all to come together and give what we got and come together in unity and we go, here's what we're thinking, and you ask questions and we ask questions and we kind of wrestle through this, that in the midst of that, somewhere God's going to show up and he's going to go, here's the plan. And we get to be part of it. I don't want you to miss that. Be here tonight, 6:30. Would you sign up and be here tonight? If you need us to pray with you today, we're going to be here after the service. But tonight, guys, please, please, please do not miss out on the opportunity of a lifetime where we can come together. And I believe this. I believe if a church comes, I don't know what God's going to do, but I want to find out. If a church came and said, God, we're willing to do this, help us. I don't know what it is, but I do know this. Whenever I've seen it in the scripture, he blows our minds. And it's going to be awesome. Let's stand for prayer.